Hello and welcome back to another episode of Critical Reactions with your host Brian. We're going to continue on with this week's theme of modern progressive, looking at progressive music that has come out in the past 24 years. Ish. Something like that. You know, ever since 2000s. Anyways, we're going to be checking out some Coheed and Cambria today. The track is called Domino the Destitute. So, let's dive into that and see what's going on with Coheed and Cambria. Interesting vocal delivery there. Yeah. So we're in groupings of three. It's just strange vocal delivery rhythm on that. Really great groove here, good pacing. Cutting out the sound for this compressed guitar over here. Bring everything back in. It's a really catchy chorus, too. Oh, and this guitar lick is one of the first riffs we heard from the guitarist. Really great use of space. We still have a lot of impact from the drums here, but overall we've reduced the intensity quite a bit. A little bit of a breather here.
Pride of
It's interesting, the music video is very cheer celebratory, but musically we're not there. And we're back to the drive now. Okay. Eerie, antagonistic, harmonically prickly. Very dramatic. Yeah, bringing the intensity back. Bringing back this opening riff. Oh, bringing back the weird vocal delivery too. That really raspy. Back to this really catchy chorus. Okay. We're about towards the end here too. Ooh, sick little bass lick right there. Interesting vocal delivery again. Also an interesting harsh right there. Yeah. Tons of energy. How do you wrap this up? You just stop it. There's just an end. Okay. I tried my best to keep an eye on the music video too. I was told that it was narratively important and does mirror things going on in the story, and since I wasn't I was also told to possibly listen to the first track coming into this too. Why do I always forget that stuff till it's not useful information? Dang, I meant to make a note too. Anyways, I paid a little bit attention to the video, but a lot of the people ended up looking very samey to me since I was only giving it half my attention. I think I got the gist of the story, but I'll try to wrap some of that up into the lyrical component later on. Right here, though, as usual, I just want to talk about the music. And what I like about this is, you know, when we get a week like this where the theme is progressive music, I kind of have an idea of what we're going to check out. It's going to be your Dream Theaters. It's going to be your Between the Buried and Me's, right? Your Porcupine Trees. Or even, well, this is modern progressive, but, you know, usually some older progressive bands show up in weeks like this. if I hadn't have put that the time limit on it for post 2000. But you know, there's the heavy hitters. They always pop up for progressive themes. What I like about this though is that it doesn't really fit in with bands like Dream Theater. What I like about this track in particular, and what I like about most of the Coheed that I've heard, which admittedly it's not a lot. I've listened to like two or three of their big hits. Welcome Home. And, well, we even reacted to that one, didn't I? But I knew that song before that video, I'm pretty sure. I don't know if I've actually reacted to that yet. You know what? I think that was for a live stream. Anyways, I'm getting way off topic. I've heard like three or four songs from them. But this fits in with my idea of who they are, which is a bit of a progressive alternative rock or progressive hard rock. And I think that's really awesome because it isn't the overly technical, massively progressive stuff that we would hear with something like Dream Theater. It is, at its core, exceptionally palatable and utilizes a lot of the ideas of a radio rock sound. It is heavier, sure, but there really isn't a lot in here that I think would keep it off the radio if they were just more popular, possibly. Welcome Home was huge on the radio, at least where I lived, but that was sort of the only single that ever made it onto the radio, even though what I've heard, I think most of it would fit just well. I don't know, I always find that kind of weird. They seem like a band that should have been bigger than they were. And the only thing I could think is that they just never got the radio time. But anyways, like, this is a very solid radio hit. We have driving riffs in here that are super cool, great to listen to. We have catchy choruses, and we have a pretty standard verse-chorus, bridge-chorus setup. A lot of the progressive elements come in very lightly. They're sprinkled in as a spice, an interesting time signature here, a variety of ideas here, a moving bass line here. It's little ideas that give the song a little bit of extra oomph, more so than change it drastically into something that I would very clearly put into some sort of progressive genre. In fact, despite this being a progressive type of hard rock, I'd be hesitant to put this under the label of progressive rock. It feels close enough to a very standard genre to me. But I think that's its strength, too. Coheed and Cambria could very easily be a bridge band. One that introduces people to progressive elements and helps them find a path to really progressive music. For instance, to your Dream Theaters and bands like them. And they do that by introducing little bits of progressive elements into a very familiar package. And that's where this song sort of sits for me, in all of the best ways. It comes in, and let me be honest here, I'm going to break this down into a very common verse-chorus, bridge-chorus structure, but by no means do I think the song really sits within that. In fact, we have like two or three sections before we even get to the first verse, and the bridge itself is broken up into two or three ideas there that are tightly interconnected, where you could view them as one idea, but I think they're diverse enough to split them up a little bit. And we even have the use of a pre-chorus in one place to help segment out the structure even further. So it's easy to talk about it because it is, again, close enough to a traditional structure that I can utilize that framework, but by no means would I say that in a more technical framework that this is a purely cookie cutter structure for the song. And it's one of those things, again, where it's just enough spice to push it towards a progressive area without actually putting it into a place that I would call it prog rock. And that's one of its big strengths. So anyways, the opening area, though, this is interesting because we kick it off with, geez, like 40 seconds almost of compressed, quiet music. All of it was like quarter volume, and then we pushed up to half volume, and this is where we introduced some ideas that would show up later. There's a guitar riff in here that shows up in the bridge, I think might have been the chorus. There is a vocal style in here. It's this little raspy goblin voice that shows up much later in our outro. There is a super compressed, well, it's a clean vocal, but in production, it's really compressed and gritty. Almost sounds like it's coming out of blown out speakers. That shows up on the left side. It does the same thing that our little goblin voice is doing, but it gives us that texture layering right there. I don't think we'll hear that again, though. But it is right here, so that's kind of neat. They've added this little idea here. But we get some information here, and it presents this rising intensity. Until we get into the verse proper, and there's just a killer riff in here. There's some fantastic drumming, lots of high intensity energy to push us into what would become the chorus. We also have some powerfully delivered vocals here, and I was kind of curious, given the goblin vocals, what kind of vocals we were going to get. And we got standard Coheed stuff, so I didn't know if I should have been in for a surprise or not. I didn't know what to expect, but we got standard Coheed vocals, so okay, we're cool with that. Now, most of the verse is just cool licks. We have a cool drum pattern. We have cool guitar stuff. We do have a little bit of harmonic work, but even that harmonic work comes through a moving line. It's more of a chord outlining than just playing straight chords. And then we have a bass, which frequently plays what the guitar is playing, but occasionally goes out on its own, usually at the end of a four-bar phrase. They do this really cool lick at the end. And so it's just this driving energy. It just keeps pushing the song forward. That's the whole point of the verse. And this takes us to the chorus, which just, it's peak energy. It takes all the energy buildup that we have and just delivers on it. We have a super catchy melody line coming out of the vocals. We have a lead guitar that does a little bit of counterpoint in the first half of the chorus to the vocals. The back half, though, it turns into chord-based stuff to line up with what the rhythm guitarist has been doing this whole time. The bass is mostly laying down foundational stuff here. And the drums, interestingly, have pulled back a little bit. The energy, the intensity, all of that's at a peak, but the number of notes that we're getting, how many times a drum is being hit, how many times a guitar is being strummed, has all been reduced. The energy comes from harmonic quality and production and atmosphere more so than speed or intensity or anything like that. The cool thing about the chorus, too, is that it is split in two. We have the more intense first half and then the more laid back. It's laid back rhythmically. Again, we just play things less often. We allow notes to ring out a little more, but it's still intense. It's still a very large section. And that's the contrast there. Driving intensity with more space versus using that intensity to hit peaks of energy with less hits to them. And we bounce back and forth between those. We got our verse, chorus. This brings us to the bridge. And I like this bridge because it's its own little mini story. And I wish more bands would do this because, well, not all bands. Just, I wish I heard it more often, I suppose I should say. A lot of the times the bridge is utilized as another bit of contrast. Your verse and your chorus are contrast, but after you've done verse, chorus, you've created a pattern. Time to get away from that pattern and explore a third idea here. But here, Coheed says the bridge is an opportunity to get away from our verse, chorus, but also I'd like to explore its own little thing here. It's a side story, according to Domino the Destitute. And so this bridge is two or three sections that it's like a linear buildup. We kind of bring the energy back down and we build it back up slowly over time with a variety of riffs and drum patterns and vocal ideas in order for the final bit of the song, which is a return to the chorus, and then taking that chorus energy and pushing it even further, bringing back so many ideas from elsewhere in the song and remixing those concepts, specific guitar riffs, specific drum patterns, specific atmospheres, bringing them all together and remixed in a new way to wrap the song up. on the highest point that it can. To get to that point, we got to build to it. So we have a little mini narrative here where we're going to start low and rise up until we can meet the energy of the chorus, transition into the chorus, and we're going to achieve that with some new stuff, new guitar riffs. Actually, we bring back one of the guitar. We bring back the intro guitar riff here with new production on it. We bring back, so it's not all new. We do bring back a lot. We bring back that goblin-y voice, but we do have a new vocal pattern that happens at the beginning of this. The bass gets to show off a little bit. There's some pockets in here where we get to hear some cool bass licks. But it's what it is. It is a, it's its own little story. If you ignore the rest, the bridge by itself is still really cool. That's not always a way I could describe bridges for every band. Sometimes if you just rip out that bridge, it's a neat idea, but it doesn't do much on its own. And Coheed's, it's its own little story. I thought that was very cool. And then, like I said, we use this to bring the energy back up and hit some new peaks towards the end of the song to end on a massive moment. And at the end of the song, as we saw, it just stops. It's just the end. There is no bringing it down. There's no, release of the energy. The song just ends. And, you know, based on the music video, there's, you know, a suicide happening. So the song just abruptly ending matches the story, I'm going to assume. Now, there is one thing that I want to bring up before I hit some lyrics here. Space. There is a lot of use of space on this. And I think it's interesting because the chorus gives us space in a different way than the verse does. Let's explore this real quick. So the verse is very intense. We have fast moving riffs coming out of the guitars, lots of energy and impact coming from the drums. We have the vocal melody on top of all of it. But there's not a lot of atmosphere here. The chorus feels bigger, even though it's not as driving. A big reason for that is that the chorus has guitar chords, whereas the verse is mostly riffs. And so we find spaciousness between the notes. Chords, if you just hold, you just, you know, make your chord shape, strum the guitar, the note rings out. It fills the space. There's no stopping between them. That's what happens in the chorus, but inversely, in the verse, when you're playing a bunch of notes, there's space between each of those attacks. It might not be a lot of space, but one note needs to end for the next one to begin. And it creates this feeling of room, of spaciousness. It also makes the entire atmosphere not feel as dense because you have these things that are constantly moving and they never get a chance to grow sonically. Like I mentioned, you strum it out, especially with the high reverb that we have in some of these guitar tones, and it just gets bigger and bigger, and just that one tone takes up so much room. You don't get that when you're playing fast. So the spaciousness is actually in the rhythm itself. I thought that was pretty cool. Well, ooh, man, that's, ugh. It's not really in the rhythm. It's in the space between notes hit. The chorus uses space in rhythm because on the second half of the chorus, you go back and listen, and they're playing their chords, right? Just full-on chords. But sometimes they'll play the chord and then mute it, and there'll be like a beat or two of silence, and that's where your space comes in the chorus. And so both of these sections have feelings of emptiness crafted in them. One's atmospherically, one's rhythmically, but they both introduce this concept of space. And I think that's really awesome. It gives Coheed at least this song specifically, it gives it a feeling of room to breathe, moments to take a breath. There is intensity in both ways, whether it's the driving energy of the verse or the empowering energy of the chorus, just the largeness of it all. And yet, despite both of those high intensity segments, there's still areas where you might be on the edge of your seat, but you're not holding your breath anymore. You just have a moment to take that quick breath and continue on the ride that they're taking you on. And I really enjoy that about them. It's a song that never quite feels overwhelming, despite for half of the song running at max intensity. And even the back half of the song, a majority of that is at full intensity too. It's just the buildup to get back that isn't, which itself is a massive area to take a breath on as well. We bring the intensity down. It allows the audience to take a breath, take a little bit of a breather before we get to the real heavy stuff. So, yeah, they use space really well on this this track. But other than the structure and the spaciousness and some of the counterpoint, it's a fairly straightforward alternative rock track or hard rock track, or wherever you want to place this. I don't know. Some of those subgenres tend to get a bit cluttered and overlappy in my mind. It's rock at the end of the day. And they do a good job of towing that line between palatable standard sounds and progressive ones. Let's hit some lyrics on this, see what's going on. Alright, so there's actually a frame story to this. The title of the song is actually more than just Domino the Destitute. That's technically the subtitle. It's called Key Entity Extraction Movement 1. What the Key Entity Extraction suite of songs is about is this character named Sirius Amory. He enters the thing called a keywork to learn more about its properties. Each of the four songs represents a different soul he comes into contact with and their memories that he is forced to experience. So, this is a song about Domino the Destitute, a person from the past whose soul has been trapped in this keywork and can be experienced. So this story is the tale of Domino's downfall. Now, this is a story of brothers. One is a fighter. The other, I don't know. I kind of remember seeing the other one fight as well, maybe in the music video. Like I said, some of the characters got blurred together. But anyways, they were really close together. Both of them had troubled pasts, but on the whole, they had each other's back. Domino ends up being a good fighter, though, and rises through the ranks undefeated and ends up catching the attention of a mobster who ends up supporting him financially and stuff, kind of talking him up, getting him into seedier and seedier situations and driving a wedge between Domino and his brother, Chess, until eventually, as we saw in the music video, Domino goes and punches Chess. The wedge between them had been driven to its worst. The thing is, though, is that Domino continued to sink more and more. In fact, the one part, the post-chorus, says, oh, we've got you by the throat, all you want to be. Welcome all to the everlasting all-time low. Put your hands together for the ever-failing one-man show, Domino. Ladies and broken gentlemen, the undisputed champ of misery. Oh, and in this corner we find his challenger, the pride of utopia, the greatest thing ever. So Domino was trying to be the best. And he wanted this life of perfection and everything. And we see in the music video that he has women around him and drugs and he's gambling and alcohol and all sorts of stuff. And so right here in the post-chorus, we see that he just keeps sinking as a person, despite rising in the boxing ranks. We will see, though, that there's a moment in the bridge where we have the announcer coming. Remember, I had mentioned that was an interesting choice. It's an announcer describing a boxing match, and Domino ends up getting knocked out in it. He's no longer undefeated, and presumably, as he has been spending his money on all sorts of things, he's kind of broke and indebted to this mobster now, and so he's left having to run a heist for this mobster and recruits his brother to it. And in the heist, his brother gets killed, as we saw in the music video. And Domino ends up taking his life because he can't deal with that. The outro says, "One by one, we are together, we fall together. Now, my brother, don't be afraid, we are together, and we'll fall together." So, yeah. Now, I'll be honest. I didn't get all of that from the lyrics. I feel like the lyrics are very surface level and don't get into a lot of that. In fact, even the bit of the heist doesn't really... I don't know. I don't really read where that comes from in the lyrics. But it is presented in both the description of the song and in the music video, as well as the supplementary material for this story. So, I don't know. Everybody tells me that the heist is in here. I don't see where it states that in the lyrics. But yeah, I mean, as just like we found out with one of the last Coheed tracks we checked out, it was a long one. It was like 20 minutes long. It was about this big war space battle with this giant dreadnought. I don't remember. There's so much in here that kind of gets lost on me. But it's not just because of the story as a whole, but also because of their single vocalist, which I don't think is as big of an issue here, but I am kind of, there's some sections that I feel are told from the perspective of Chess and some that are told from the perspective of Domino. Maybe it's just that I don't know these characters and where I feel like we have a characteristic switch, there isn't one, but I can't really go on if there's a new vocalist or not because there's only one vocalist. So, I don't know. As usual, when it comes to Coheed, though, the lyrics are neat. And I'm kind of a sucker for nerdy sci-fi stories, especially told through music. I'm a sucker for musicals in general, but something about Coheed's just always sort of bounces off of me. I don't know if it's because I'm consistently thrown into the middle of stories, but I really love their music, and that's where I sit with this one, too. The lyrics are okay, the story they tell is fine, but honestly, the music is what stands out the most to me on this one. So, those are my thoughts. Coheed and Cambria's Key Entity Extraction Movement 1 Domino the Destitute. What did you think of this track? Is there anything that stood out to you? Anything you'd like to add on to what I said or correct me on? Maybe just have your own thoughts, opinions, and perspectives about this track. Toss all of that down in the comments section. Above that, in the description box, you'll find a link to Linktree. Takes you here. You can find links to my music, ways to support the channel, a link to the Discord server, and so much more. Above that, if you could, like, subscribe, and ring the bell. I greatly appreciate all three of those. That wraps it up for this one, but we do have a special selection coming up next. You can check that out. Otherwise, I'll be back tomorrow, 5 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, 9 p.m. UTC, as usual. Until next time, remember to be critical, not cynical, of the music you listen to, and have a fantastic morning, afternoon, or evening, whenever you choose to watch my videos.